Eric, we'll give it one more minute. There's seven attendees so far.
Just quickly before we get rolling, Eric or Zach, can you make sure Jacob has the ability to share his screen? He'll be sharing his screen later on.
Yep, should be all good.
You think, should we get going? It's 6:33 now, so we're gonna move forward with the discussion this evening on the Fleet Street reconstruction project. I wanna thank everyone for attending. Tonight we have the city's consulting engineer, Underwood Engineers, led by Keith Pratt, going through the Fleet Street, the first public meeting on the Fleet Street project, taking public input on the Fleet Street corridor. This project is one of the many projects in our capital improvement plan. We've been planning for this for a number of years and is really driven by a need for sewer separation in this particular area. However, while we're doing sewer separation, we're also planning for overall utility improvements in the greater Fleet Street area, which extends out all the way to Maplewood, down to Hanover, and up into Market Square. So we had a kickoff meeting to talk about utilities. We've done some other field work in this area already. And the purpose of this evening, which Keith will go through, is really to take public input on people's ideas associated with what needs to be done in this particular corridor. So before we go, I was just gonna introduce the city staff members. My name's Terry Damaris, I'm the city engineer. With us is Peter Rice, the director of public works, David DeVosis, the city's construction project coordinator, Zach Cronin, assistant city engineer, and Eric Eby, our city transportation engineer. I also wanted to recognize Mayor Beckstead, who is in the audience, as well as Stephanie Secord. With that, I'll turn this over to Keith Pratt so we can move forward with introductions of the team and the presentation.
Okay, thanks, Terry. And before I start the presentation, I want to introduce myself, Keith Pratt. I'm president of Underwood Engineers. I have my project manager, Dan Rochette, here, one of our project engineers, Jake Standen, and our landscape architects, Robbie Woodburn and Vicky Martell, are also with us. So I'll share my screen. Somebody acknowledge that that's working? Okay. I'm going to take a few, probably 10, 15 minutes or so, just to do an introduction and a background on what we're doing here. And then we're going to enter into, as Terry noted, the public engagement process. And that's where we're going to want to seek input. This is our meeting number one. There will be more meetings. We're focusing on the Fleet Street reconstruction project, as Terry mentioned. We already went through the introductions. I'll just note Zach Cronin is the primary contract project manager for this project from the city. I already introduced our team. Dan Rochette is the project manager, who's the primary contact for our team. Sebago Technics is helping us with some of the traffic and signalization work. I don't believe they're on the call tonight, but they've been involved with the team. Today, we're going to be give you a little background on the purpose and the goals and the background is on the project itself, plus the work that's been completed to date. We have done some work, mostly field collection, field work and data collection. Talk about the schedule, what we've done for public information and outreach and what we're going to do. And then we're going to jump into really the primary purpose for this meeting is that to seek input. So today we just mentioned background, work complete, public, what we've done so far, but we're really talking about the engagement today. We really want to engage the stakeholders, the neighbors, and the folks that are interested in this project to get ideas before we begin design. So what this is a listening session. When we get to the end, we'll take turns listening to folks on what they want to identify as their wish list for projects, ideas, issues, concerns, problems. We're starting from a blank slate. We do not have a presentation today for concepts. We do not have designs developed. We haven't started that effort. Our goal here is to get the input before we go into the design phase. In fact, we don't even have project budgets at this point. Design alternatives will be presented and design options and the selected options will be in future meetings. So they're going to come. But if you're hoping to see some design concepts today, we're not at that point. The study area is broad, just to make sure that we're planning for this properly. It really brackets between these four key areas: of the downtown, Market Square, Hanover Garage, the Worth parking area, and Court Street. So that's what we're looking at. It's kind of a broad view of everything. We're focusing on the utility improvements on Fleet Street itself, and as Terry mentioned, roadway improvements as well. But because utilities interconnect at all the other intersecting streets, Congress and Hanover and State Street, we're looking closely at those as well, and Vaughan Mall included, because there are utilities under Vaughan Mall. The background, as Terry mentioned, it's driven by a consent decree the city has with EPA, where there's a required work on Fleet Street. The consent decree is limited to Fleet Street. The goal or the requirement of the consent decree is to separate the sewers. Really what that is in Fleet Street right now has a sewer and drain pipe combined. So those flows are in one pipe. Our primary goal for this project is to separate those pipes. We will have a separate sewer pipe and a separate storm drain. The utilities that we anticipate to be impacted and improved with this project are on Fleet Street, of course, and as if needed, we would do some of the adjacent stems on Congress, Hanover, and Vaughan, either with this project or at some point in the future, but we're certainly completing the design on them just to make sure that we understand what the long-term needs are. We also anticipate at some point there may be a possible stormwater outfall improvement. There is a stormwater outfall in North Mill Pond where this drains, and that would likely need to be improved at some point too. So again, we're focusing on the Fleet Street area between Hanover and Court, but recognizing there are utilities and other improvements that we would like to look at and understand that are adjacent to the Fleet Street area. So far we've done primarily field work and data collection, done surveys of the area, done some inventories of the traffic circles, intersections. We've done some subsurface investigations to look at the soils and the materials under the roadway. Some of you may know or have been involved where we've knocked on your door, entered your buildings to ask permission to take a look at the utilities and how they connect in the street to help us in our design efforts. So we appreciate that. I think we were very successful into getting into most of the buildings. We have done some public information so far as well. There was an introductory public meeting in September last fall, where we just introduced the project, let people know things were going to happen and things were coming. There was a utility coordination meeting, and that was in advance of us entering people's buildings to explain what we were doing and why. There was some door-to-door notices, I believe, that were completed back in December as well. City is maintaining a website specific to this project, so you're welcome to see that and keep the tabs on the project information that will be available there. This meeting, as we engage more with the public, is we are dealing with this is the first time we're really engaging you in terms of what we want to hear for design ideas. We are starting with a blank slate. We're looking at things from improving pedestrian accommodations, roads, traffic, bikes, seating, green space, traffic patterns, anything and everything is sort of on the table in terms of what those ideas may be. We'll talk about how we're going to deal with them in future phases, but we're here to listen. The benefit with this approach is that what we want to do is be armed with the ideas and the concerns and the priorities that folks have before we start the design phase, so that we can then go back and do our best to accommodate them. If we can't accommodate them, we can come back and explain why, or at least understand or help you understand why we couldn't. But that's the purpose for doing this first. After we go to that design phase and collect information today, we will be coming back to the public in the summer, this summer, and to present the alternatives, and likely this fall, hopefully we'll be landing on a chosen alternative. So those will be future engagement sessions with the public. Keep in mind too, we have not started design. We expect to start design this summer and fall. And we are not targeting construction until 2023. So if the thought is we're going to be in Fleet Street right away, that's not the intent at this point. This is go through a few slides, a few photographs of the area. I'm sure most all of you know or are familiar with it, but this may just help you get your more recollection. This is Fleet Street itself, standing at Hanover, looking south. You got the Hanover Garage on the left. And you can see some of the utility poles and the overhead utilities there, and the condition of the road and the sidewalks. We've got Fleet Street here, standing more with Congress to the back. And now we're looking at Hanover and the condition of the road, the sidewalks, and so forth. This area is also Fleet Street, probably taken about a week or two ago, as some of the restaurants, I think this is the Franklin Oyster Bar, setting up for their outdoor seating for the season. We are now at Congress Street and Fleet Street intersection, looking north this time. Congress Street is passing left to right here. Fleet Street is you're looking right towards the Hanover side of Fleet Street. This is also Fleet Street at the TD Bank. Now we're looking south. I think you got State Street there at the top of the hill on the left. You can see the condition of the road and the curbing. This is a view of Congress Street. Now we're looking towards Fleet Street. You got Jumping Jays and the Goat on the right. This is the area where I think there's some current outdoor seating being set up. This is also some outdoor seating on Congress Street, in front of the Bagel Works and the Thirsty Moose. And then here's some photographs of the Vaughan Mall and some of the outdoor seating that's there. There are some utilities under here that we are looking at. Some more views of the Vaughan Mall. This is at La Coretta. Here's some examples. We have helped the city in some of the downtown areas before. This is Shafe Street before on the upper left, and after on the bottom right. Just some of those. These were also driven by utility projects, but the surface improvements were completed, sidewalks, curbing, and the roadway as well. There's another view of Shafe Street on the left bottom before, and on the top right after. And then here's a project in Islington Street showing some of the improvements on the sidewalks as well. Another thing we want to point out is if you're not comfortable talking or speaking up in this session, we have other opportunities for some public engagement. Underwood has offered, as part of our work with the city, to open, scheduled appointments with our staff to either meet in person in a COVID-friendly way or do it on an interactive chat where you can get a one-on-one with Dan or one of our engineers just to talk about it and share some of your ideas. We would welcome you to call our, we're going to do this between May 17th and June 25th. So please write that down if you're interested. There's our telephone number. There's our storefront. We happen to be located right on the Vaughan Mall, so it's very easy to find us. You will be speaking or wanting to ask for Carrie Windsor in our office, and she knows that you may be calling, and to set up those appointments, she'll work to make that happen. And we are located, again, as I mentioned, right on the Vaughan Mall. So if we wanted to go take a look at something on the ground, it's very easy to do. Okay, so we're gonna get ready here to start listening to folks and opening it up. And the way we're going to do that is we're just going to listen. We want to hear from you on this and what your issues and goals are. When we do, we're going to write them down. If you ask us how we're going to handle something, we're really probably going to say we're not sure yet. I mean, everything is on the table. We have it. We intentionally did not start into some of our design work for that reason. So we want to know what your ideas and considerations are. We recognize that you may have some priorities and certain compromises would have to be made, but interested to know, you know, if you would favor one thing over another. And again, it's a blank slate. We have not done the design work yet. So, you know, what is important to you? And pedestrian accommodations, traffic patterns, ideas and thoughts on that, landscape and trees, bike accommodations. Shall we talk about utilities and burying the overhead utilities, parking? Do you want parking? Or would you prefer something else like the outdoor seating and any ideas on curbing realignments and other things? Again, we're focusing on the Fleet Street area. We recognize that we may be working some utilities outside that, so where possible, I know the city's interested in trying to accommodate, make surface improvements as well. Fleet Street is the priority. I mean, we're going to open up the conversation to anything on Fleet Street and close by. But we are aware too, and just reminding folks that there are other things happening or will be happening potentially with some master planning around the Market Square. We know we're aware of that. We know that there's some efforts with the Mayor's Blue Ribbon Committee and the Vaughan Mall to look at long-term improvements there. So we're tuned into the fact that there's some things there. We also know, and we mentioned it, the outdoor seating is things that are happening right now. So what we'll be doing, and this is where I'll be turning the screen over to Jake from our office, and Eric from the city calls on folks, we're going to be zooming in right where you might have a comment, and we'll be writing in those comments. This is an example. I would like to bury the overhead utilities. And so that's how we're going to handle this work session. If somebody else has the same comment, we'll probably put a couple ticks there to indicate how many times that comment came up. So hopefully that will help facilitate discussion, track our comments, and be able to collect them at the end and share those for folks to see us to utilize during design. We will also in parallel be tracking the comments sort of by category. So if something has to do with pedestrian or bicycle, we'll list them here. If it's traffic or parking, we'll list them in the second column and so forth. And so at the end, we will have a fairly good summary of comments and what kind of trends we are seeing. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Eric Ibe. He's going to go a little over, I think, on the logistics and how this will work. And then Underwood will share the screens again, and I'll sort of facilitate that discussion, I think, as Eric calls on people. So Eric, if you want to take it from this point, you're muted.
Yeah. Of course. So when anybody wants to talk, you know, raise your virtual hand, and then I will call on you and allow you to talk. And then when you're done, we'll wrap it up and we'll go on to the next person. So if everybody's familiar with it, you have a raise a hand somewhere on your screen, usually at the bottom, depending on what device you're using. If you click on that, then I will see you. I see Mike De La Cruz has raised his hand. So,
all right. So let me take a minute to stop sharing and get Jacob to call up the aerial so he can start tracking notes.
So again, anybody who wants to line up to speak can raise your hand right now and we'll call on you in the order.
Okay, so do we have somebody ready, Eric?
Yes, Mike De La Cruz. Go ahead, Mike.
How's that? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now. Yes.
Hi, good. Good evening. Hi. So let's see. I just wanted to go over with you. I just had three or four comments that I think you might find useful. So if you don't know me, I own the Franklin Block, which is located on the corner of Fleet and Congress Street. And so the building runs down about 130 some odd feet down on Fleet Street. And then there's a driveway in the building, right? You're moving your hand there. And then the next building over would be 154 Fleet Street. So you'll see something, it says the Franklin there. That's for the Franklin Oyster House. And then on the other side of the building in the Vaughan Mall is Pretty Little Things. So the input I wanted to give you, first thing is we had a Mother's Day storm years ago, and it was, you know, pretty severe storm, and it lasted for several days. And what happened at the building was that handicap ramp that is on Congress Street, as you're heading down Congress Street, right at the corner of Congress and Fleet Street at my building, water actually ran up the handicap ramp and into the retailer suite. And I had mentioned to, you know, Dave DeFosis years ago that at some point it would probably be, you know, wise to maybe put some type of a storm drain or catch basin or diverter or something right there, exactly where you have that. And so that was the only time that it flooded into the building, but I, you know, anyway, I thought I would mention it to you. So that was the first thing. The second thing
is, I'm sorry, Mike, if I could just stop you for a second, it is JCAP that captured, right? Flooded,
yeah,
you passed have it and into building?
Yeah, what happened was there's okay, two great, retail thank suites you. On the corner, and it just goes in their door. Okay. Yeah. So, that has only happened once that I can remember. So it's not an ongoing thing, but just when you get those big storms. So the other thing was telephone poles. I know that it's an ongoing battle to get the you know, the telephone poles and the power utilities underground all around the city. And I know it's an expensive proposition. The thing that I would like to emphasize, if possible, is there's telephone poles that are located, there's two of them kind of at the back of the building on Fleet Street by the driveway there. And one of them, for some reason, is cabled to the Franklin Block building. And because of the distance that that cable runs, and how it interferes with getting scaffolding and things there, I'm unable to do any maintenance on that side of the building or do some modifications. I have plans to put windows in there, and we tried to work around them when I did some work on that side of the building 7 years ago or something. And some of the electricians wouldn't complete, the masons wouldn't complete the work because they're afraid of the getting shocked. And you know, the Eversource can only protect them so much. So I would be a big fan of taking that off the building and getting the overhead utilities put under the street.
Can you help Jake point that arrow to that? Is it more near the 152?
Yeah, it's right now 148.
They 148.
Got it right. Okay. So it's, yeah, that wire extends the where you see 152, Jake. That's where the telephone pole is, and the cable that secures it in place runs, you know, approximately over to 148, maybe a little north of 148. But yeah, and you know, long term, it's not a good thing to have a telephone pole, you know, bolted to the side of a 150-year-old brick building. So okay, but I do, that one's an important one. Let's see.
Jake, maybe we could just indicate that Mr. Dela Cruz is in favor of burying the utilities.
Yes.
Thank you.
If at all possible, you know, it doesn't look, it's a little unsightly on Fleet Street. So whatever you can do, I'd be a big supporter.
Jake, why don't you add a comment above this one in support of burying the utilities then?
Yeah. The fellas from Flowtech called me a while ago, I think before the holidays, and for some reason we weren't able to get together, and so I could walk them around the building and show them where everything is. I had wanted to put things on a site plan, because we have a lot of different sewer pipes that come out, and they come out on, I believe, on three different sides of the building, and they're used by different tenants. So I would just, if you could just, you know, either in your minutes or something, just let me know who I should send those to, because I want to make sure you have a good record of those.
Okay, we'll make a point. And maybe Jake, you could put that on the spreadsheet on the other page, just to make sure there's some coordination there on the services.
Yeah, I just want to make sure you got them. There's a whole lot of them, so you I know that if you one comes up by surprise, you're not happy. And some of those sewer lines, they go back a very, very long time. Okay. And then in terms of, you know, the aesthetics, this is my last point, and then I'll go. In terms of the aesthetics for Fleet Street, I learned something with the outdoor seating and over the last year and then this year. And I think it would be an improvement on Fleet Street if it was narrowed to a one-way street and the sidewalks, you know, were maybe doubled in size. I'm not sure you need that on Gilly's side, but it seems like it would make a lot of sense on, I guess you would call it the west side, because there's a lot of retail businesses along that side of the street. And I think it would also help with maintenance of the building, because right now the sidewalk is too small to accommodate normal scaffolding. And if it was, you know, widened enough for tables and chairs and things like that, as well as pedestrians, it would be good for maintaining the 150-year-old brick and the windows and all that. But it would also be good for the, there's three food service retailers on that side of the building, and they would all benefit from that. And it may be of value to the other two hospitality shops all the way down the other end of Fleet Street towards Hanover. So there's a lot of activity there that would probably benefit by having outdoor seating there. And if the road came down Congress Street and then made a right-hand turn onto Fleet Street, I think that would, you know, alleviate most of the traffic problems and get everybody to the parking garage, as well as access to the businesses along that street. So thinking about it, I was not originally in favor of it, but after thinking about it and watching how the Franklin Oyster House does, I would be strongly in favor of making it a one-way and allowing for restaurant seating on the outside on Fleet Street. If provisions weren't made for restaurant seating, I'm not sure how much benefit it would be, other than allowing for better maintenance of the historic buildings on either side of the street. So that's my comments for tonight.
Thanks, Mike. Clarify that wider sidewalks preferred? Did I hear you say really only if it's to the benefit of having outdoor seating for the restaurants, or is that in general?
I think, you know, living with this thing for a long time, if the sidewalk was even 1 foot bigger, it would greatly aid in maintaining this. You know, there's 130 feet there of historic building to maintain the windows, the woodwork and the brick. And that would allow for standard scaffolding to be put there rather than have to protrude out into the street, if even 1 foot larger. So that's the maintenance thought. And then in terms of I think it would be very good for all the businesses on the west side of that street to have the possibility of outdoor seating along there, because I can immediately count five hospitality businesses right on Fleet Street on that west side. So my preference would be, if you make it a one way, certainly allow for seating on that area. Otherwise, I'm not sure it really buys you anything. That's my opinion.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hey, anybody else? We don't have any hands raised right now, but if anybody else would like to speak, there we go. Sam Weinbaum. Go ahead, Sam.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Hello?
Hello, we can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Hello? I can't hear you.
We can hear you.
Can you hear me, Keith?
Yes.
Oh, okay, sorry. So Sam Weinbaum, Keith and Underwood Engineers know me quite well because they're in my building at 29 Vaughan Street. And I sort of have a technical question, but also before I ask a technical question, even though it doesn't directly affect the Vaughan Mall, burying the utilities underground and widening the sidewalk, at least on one side, I think would be a big positive. That sidewalk is super, super narrow. I really, if it became a one-way street, not sure which direction, I think it would be a very positive thing. That is a really narrow sidewalk. And in the winter, it's even narrower. But my question for Keith and Underwood Engineers is just why is Fleet Street sort of the focus and not the whole area? And then the second thing, and you can add it to the list, is with my building, I come down through Mike Dela Cruz's alley for the electric service. And at some point, both of us are going to need to, if the poles come down, consider how we get the main service into both of those buildings from that side. So after seeing what's there, it's very crowded with poles, transformers, all kinds of stuff. Mike's transformers is that we come off of is in the alley, but it sounds like it may need to be a fairly major underground manhole kind of service transformer situation, feed whatever off of Fleet Street to all those buildings. But my first question is why Fleet Street first? Why is that the focus?
Do we lose Keith? Sam, it looks like we lost Keith, but I'll go ahead and start with a response to that question in regards to why Fleet Street. And the short answer is that, as we discussed earlier, the city has a consent decree with the Environmental Protection Agency to do certain sewer separation projects, and Fleet Street is one of those projects. So that's why the focus has been primarily on Fleet Street from Hanover to Court. However, we recognize that there's a number of other projects and items ongoing in the area. You know, as Keith had mentioned, the Blue Ribbon Committee on the Vaughan Mall. We've been looking closely at the utilities, particularly sewer on Congress Street and in the Vaughan Mall. And that's why we broadened out the entire study area to include everything in the blue in addition to Fleet Street, was because we don't want to be exclusive to that area, but we do have to have some limit on the project in order to establish the funding. Fleet Street was kind of the limits based on our requirements with the consent decree, but we are evaluating the entire area as best we can. And if we have to extend it, we'll extend it. But right now that's kind of why Fleet Street was identified in particular.
Terry, no, my question is specific. What did the EPA see in Fleet Street? Why specifically Fleet Street technically, or in terms of, you know, the consent decree?
Yeah, so Fleet Street has the highest concentration of combined sewers in this area. And when we had to identify for what's called our long-term control plan to reduce combined sewer overflows, we were targeting the areas that have the most combined sewers, and Fleet Street happens to be one of those.
And thank you.
Yep.
Okay, Sam, did you have anything else, Sam, or is that all for you?
One more thing, just I've been on the ad hoc committee for the Vaughan Mall. And I think what happens, you know, on the Vaughan Mall on the surface after any work is really of major importance to the city overall, with all the new construction further down and the Vaughan Mall as being the kind of gateway. I'm sure what happens underground will be, you know, what you need to do. but the timing and the planning, and even including thoughts about the future with the Worth lot, you know, there may be elements that need to be planned for, even if they're not done with the Worth lot in consideration, in terms of utilities and availability of utilities, location of transformers, all kinds of things. And also this, you know, the storm sewer water, so on and so forth. So I'm sure you're looking at that, but just thought I'd bring it up.
We'll get that noted down, Sam, but we are certainly taking into consideration or aware of, you know, all the overlapping priorities here when it comes to the Vaughan Mall area.
And sorry, Sam, I got disconnected, but back connected. And Eric, if you could change my name again.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, Mayor Beckstead, we have mayors up next.
Can you hear me, Eric?
Yes, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Good evening, everybody. I just for curiosity, when approximately, I know you guys are in the planning stages, when approximately is this going to, somewhat are you thinking is going to go into effect? Are you going to start, I guess, doing the construction itself?
We're planning on a 2023 start, right, Terry? I just want to make sure I have that correct. But
I mean, based on the needs of getting this done in the time frame of the consent decree, that would put us starting around the 2023 time frame. It's something we've been thinking about, Mayor, as it relates to the 400th anniversary. But in the effort to get this prepared and ready to go, you know, we're continuing to move forward with the design efforts.
Okay, so but you're still not sure if you're going to be actually doing it in 2023, seeing that that is our 400th anniversary. Last thing I would like to see, and again, I know it's only 2 years out, but the last thing I want to see, would see the roads ripped up. I know that we have certain responsibilities. The other thing too, during the planning stages, you guys had mentioned, I think it was Mr. De La Cruz that talked about the restaurant using the sidewalks in the way that we have. And I know this is going to become a big discussion starting next year when hopefully with enough luck, we won't have to be in this pandemic world. And that is the discussions that the next council will actually have to take up. But as you're designing it, one of the concerns that I have is it was raised at the reopen committee within the last 2 weeks. I believe it was Martha Fowler Clark. That street was temporarily closed for the dining that was taking place there. And I know they had talked about seeing if we could open it up so that you had the ability for cars to go up and down there. The last thing I want to see is this road narrower any more so than what it is right now to be able to have both sides of the street open. There are restaurants that are on there. There are residents that are in there as well. And to be able to have that open for a two-way is going to be still vitally important in this section of town.
So to make sure we capture these comments right, I think I heard two. One was to be concerned about working around the 400th anniversary. So Jake, make sure we put that down. And the second one, if I heard you, Mayor, correctly, is that your preference is to maintain two-way on Fleet.
It has to be. I mean, the modifications that we've done for the dining now, I know if this becomes more of a permanent in some manner, in some way, widening of the sidewalks makes sense. The only problem is we still need to maintain a two-way in that section. We've had that blocked off, and there have been several restaurants where they're actually losing business. And the last thing I want to do when we're creating a permanent road is to have that same obstruction going on with the design moving forward. I want to make sure that stays a two-way.
Did you capture, did we get those both, Jake? I think we did, right? Yeah. Okay. Just want to make sure we captured your comments correctly, Mayor.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else would like to speak? Please raise your virtual hand. Not seeing anybody else at this time. Nope. Great.
So Keith, you want to just briefly summarize the next steps here for those in attendance, and then we can wrap up.
Yep, sure. Thank you, Terry. Yes, and what we'll do, Terry, is compile these notes, clean them up a little bit, and then issue a copy of this PowerPoint so you can post it on the website. And I understand it's recorded, so that's available too. And then we'll be going back, and our next steps will be, there may be some other interim steps. We'll wait for our, see what kind of opportunities we have for some one-on-one sessions. And then we're going to be beginning the preliminary design phase. And I will mention that we are under contract for preliminary design at this point. And then we will be opening up or moving towards those next public meetings this summer and fall. So we appreciate the feedback. And that's where I think back to you.
Okay. Well, I want to thank everyone for attending this evening, and do want to ask that if you happen to see others in the area that you believe might have or want to have some input on this and could not attend or weren't interested in attending this, that they reach out to the city, Zach or Underwood, in order to provide that. Anytime that we can get more people on our distribution list for the project is helpful as well. So do appreciate everyone attending, and thank you and have a nice evening.
Thank you, everybody.